Hello everyone. Dr. Amreen has some technical issues because of which she'll be joining late. I would like to request Dr. Sara Umar, can you please chair the session instead of Dr. Amreen Javed?
Okay, Zara, I'll do that. No problem.
Okay, thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you for your cooperation. Okay, so good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm your panel coordinator, Zara Ijaz, from Institute of English Studies, Punjab University. Okay, so we have with us Dr. Amreen Javed. Thank you so much. Hello, Dr. Amreen. Can you hear me? I think she has again left the meeting. So we will begin. Okay, she has joined. Hello, Dr. Amreen, can you hear us? Hello, Dr. Amreen Javed, can you hear me? Am I audible?
Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Thank you so much for joining. And thank you everyone for your patience and cooperation. So we are officially beginning the session. Good afternoon everyone, and I'm your panel coordinator Zara Ijaz from Institute of English Studies, Punjab University. A huge welcome to all for session 1, panel 1B, that spotlights Kashmir Palestine immigrants and crisis of contemporary borders. Thank you all for joining the panel. Thank you, Dr. Amreen Javed, who is at the moment chairperson, Department of Political Science, and also the Director Center for South Asian Studies. We highly appreciate your worthy presence. We are also obliged that presenters and attendees have also joined us. I'll now share the house rules and will then hand over to the microphone to the panel chair, Dr. Amreen Javed. Okay, so attendees must keep their cameras off and microphones mute throughout the session. Presenters may keep their cameras on throughout the panel. All questions should be sent in the meeting chat box and will be entertained in the end by the panel chair. The questions will be read by panel chair. The presenters shall use present now option from the Google Meet bar when within the panel to display their PowerPoint slides. A coordinator will ensure time management by sending a reminder in the chat box. Every speaker shall have 10 minutes to present their topics. The chair shall take over to affirm the time management once the presentation time is over. So thank you everyone for joining. I would now request the panel chair, Dr. Amreen Javed, to please carry the session forward. Over to you, Dr. Amreen Javed. Hello, ma'am. Am I audible? I think there are some technical issues. So we will wait for another 1 to 2 minutes. Thank you so much, everyone.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am, you are now audible.
Okay, thank you so much. So first of all, thank you so much for inviting me to this first International Arts and Humanities Conference. I'm delighted to be part of it. I welcome all the participants of this session. And I'm very sure that we would be listening to very enlightening views from all of our respectable, honorable speakers. And so all of you are most welcome over here. And we will start off. And in the last, we will have question and answers. And then I will wind up with my comments in the end. So we would start off with our first speaker, Dr. Sara Umar. Sara, can you hear us?
Yes, ma'am, I can. Thank you.
So please go ahead.
Okay. Let me just share my slides. The tab is not visible. Just a minute. Okay, sir. Okay, it's a screen visible to everyone.
No, ma'am, it's not visible yet.
Let me try again. Is it visible now?
Yes.
Is the screen visible?
No. It came visible for a short period, then again it disappears. Can you please try again?
Yeah, it is visible now.
Okay, is it visible? Should I start? Is it visible?
It was a while ago, but I think you took it off.
I think I started the slideshow and I think then it goes off. So I think, is it visible now?
No, nothing is visible. No,
it's not visible.
That's strange. Because it's visible on my side and it says that it's visible. Is it visible now?
Yes, it is.
Okay, it's the slideshow or just the screen?
It's better if you had kept it that way because I think there may be some problem. You're doing it the slideshow and it is like going away. So you can keep it that way.
Present okay, is it visible now?
No, not now.
Okay, let me try it again. I think this was the problem initially as well for with the first session as well, because we were not able to see any slideshow in the first session as well. Let me just stick with the darker slideshow then. Okay, is it visible now?
No, ma'am.
Still not visible?
No, still not visible.
That is something which is pretty strange because it's visible on my end.
Zara?
What about now?
Zara?
It is visible. Don't press the...
I will not press the slideshow button now. Okay, I'll begin. Okay, I'll stick with the one slide version. Okay, my name is Dr. Zara Umar, and the topic of my presentation today is role of religion in the lives of South Asians, a case study of Rohingya and Kashmiri Muslims. As a scholar and researcher of history, many a times we come across information and situations that indirectly or casually link our present to our past and future. It is under such circumstances that one leaves behind one's original field of interest to jump into something different in a quest not only to save the present, but the past for the future too. Here I would quote Professor Salveja, who says that, and I quote, "Political issues are too serious to be left only to politicians. The history of humanity is full of examples where man for his own vested interest had manipulated religion. The story of South Asia is no different." Even the slides are not coming. I don't know what's wrong with this. Okay. The story of South Asia is no different. However, when we trace the history of this region, beginning from the Indus Valley Civilization, we come across multiple examples when religion played a major role to bring and sustain peace, as we belong to a land whose ancestors believed in equality, as is evident from the lifestyle of the Indus man. Here I would like to share a few slides of the Indus Valley Civilization. And I must tell you that this is the only civilization in the history of humanity that did not produce any kind of weaponry for a good 5,000 years. This is the first site of this civilization. It is in Mehergarh, which is near the present city of Quetta these days. And when we look at the infrastructure of this civilization, because the script is undeciphered to this point, we see that there was an influx of people from Central Asia and West Asia. But what the people of this civilization were doing, but they were expanding. So this is the initial expanding plan, which began from Mehergarh, and then the civilization spread from present-day Afghanistan to partially parts of present-day India. Their infrastructure was not for a certain elite. Their infrastructure was for the masses. So the masses of this civilization facilitated from the infrastructure. This is the modern day swimming pool of today. It is known as the Great Bath in Mohenjo-Daro. Then they had granaries for storage purposes. Then this is the first map of South Asia, because this city was a little far away from the water resources. This was their seaport, Lothal. Then we see that their sewage system was covered up with stones, which is something that is even unlike today in the walled city of Lahore. They were the pioneers in building the bathing platform and the toilet seat. They had an excellent sanitation system. But then what happened in the next 800 years after the demise of the civilization? The Hindu religion sprang. And because the Hindu religion was, due to its caste system, it was very suffocating. So two people from this land, who are known as Buddha and Mahavira, rejected their royal positions and they started preaching equality among humans. Moreover, we witnessed religious tolerance being practiced during the regime of Ashoka, Kanishka, Harsha, and Akbar to win the hearts of their subjects and thus brought prosperity to the region. I shall quote a paragraph from the book Oriental Heritage, which explains the unique relationship that the people of this land still have and have always had with religion. In no other country is religion so powerful or so important as in India. If the Hindus have permitted alien governments to be set over them again and again, it is partly because they did not care much who ruled or exploited them. natives or foreigners. The crucial matter was religion, not politics. The soul, not the body. Endless later life rather than this passing one. When Ashoka became a saint and Akbar almost adopted Hinduism, the power of religion was revealed over even the strongest man. In our century, it is a saint rather than a statement who, for the first time in the history, has unified all India. Hence, it is true that we can only win the hearts of South Asian by capturing their love for religion to rule them. And this can only be achieved if the ruling political parties exercise religious tolerance. However, today it seems that instead of practicing religious tolerance to sustain peace, the ruling political parties in several countries of the region are using religion to create rifts among the masses, leading to unrest and bloodshed. So the question is, whose agenda are these parties following? Because the duty of any government is to ensure the safety of all its subjects, regardless of the religion they follow. Considering the current political and religious unrest in South Asia due to the radical religious mindset of some religious groups, and to understand why such situation arise, and to validate my stand, the religion since its birth has been manipulated, three countries from the region have been selected. Sri Lanka and Burma in relation to Buddhism, while India in relation to Hinduism, to reflect upon the current incidents taking place in all these countries to oppress the innocent population. Initially, the discussion will begin with Sri Lanka and Burma, later to be followed by India. Sri Lanka and Burma are separated by 1,000 miles of the Indian Ocean, where Buddhism, a religion of peace and selflessness, is practiced by the masses of the ruling state. Yet, the minorities are under threat and are facing atrocities beyond human comprehension. The special target of these atrocities are mostly Muslims, who are generally a peaceful minority in both countries. But a more puzzling point is that neither country is facing any Islamic militant threat. Nevertheless, in both countries, Buddhist monks are holding rallies against Muslims, are calling for direct action against them, are boycotting their products, are damaging small businesses, hence are affecting their livelihoods. The point of concern is not their undue reaction towards a minority, but the stand that they have taken, which is against their religious beliefs and ideology. Let us go back a little in time to see how Buddha and Buddhists reacted under vulnerable situations, which was completely in line with their religious ideology. It is widely known that Buddha himself prevented a war from taking place between his own clan, that is the Sakas and the Kolyas, over a water dispute. It is stated that upon his arrival in the battlefield, he engaged the opposing parties into conversation, highlighting the fact whether it was worthy to shed the blood of fellow human beings over water. Another classical example was set by Emperor Ashoka in the 3rd century BC, when after the destructive bloodshed war of Kalinga, he felt remorse and not only embraced Buddhism, but promoted it as a religion of peace too. According to popular sources, there were only 8 stupas in the subcontinent before his conversion. But during his 40 years of rule, this number increased to 84,000 stupas, which indicates his love for promoting and sustaining peace. However, there are some Buddhist texts that do sanction taking lives under exceptional circumstances, that is, while protecting the Sangha but affecting the innocents. Nevertheless, Theravada and Mahayana Buddhists completely reject these justification for taking lives, as according to them, it is against the basic Buddhist belief of no harm. Nevertheless, today, many Buddhist monks are working against these norms, despite their strong no harm religious teaching, as is rightly said by Allen, a fellow at Oxford, in one of his magazine articles, "Why are Buddhist monks attacking the Muslim?" He says, and I quote, "Of all the moral precepts instilled in Buddhist monks, the promise not to kill comes first. And the principle of non-violence is arguably more central to Buddhism than any other religion. So why have monks been using hate speech against Muslims and joining mobs that has left dozens dead? An apparent reason can be traced through history, which teaches us that no matter how a religion begins and for whatever reasons, sooner or later it's enters a partisan pact with the ruling body or elite." Allen further says, and I quote, "Buddhist monks look to kings, ultimate wielders of violence, for the support, patronage, and order that only they could provide. Kings look to monks to provide the popular legitimacy that only such a high moral vision can confer. The result seems ironic. If you have a strong sense of the overriding moral superiority of your worldview, then the need to protect and advance it may seem the most important duty of all. Therefore, some individuals preaching a certain religion manipulate it to gain their vested interest at the cost of compromising the true spirit of religion, as is said by Allen, and I quote, that Buddhism has been no more a religion of peace than any other religion in the world. Moreover, the Burmese Bin Laden Varathu, in one of his interviews to The Guardian, proudly proclaimed that he is just protecting his people, but the question is, against what? A peaceful minority? He, in an interview given to the Time magazine in 2030, complained that the Muslims are breeding so fast, they are of a woman, they would very soon occupy our country. In another interview, he said, "We are not carrying out violence, but we are protecting the public." In Sri Lanka, during recent times, the zealous group known as Vaduvala Sena and Buddhist Power Force has widely propagated against the Muslim. Their stance is that the small Muslim community is lethal to the country's integrity and a major threat to the Buddhist nation. The unjust stance of both countries is under criticism by some monks like Dalai Lama, who has proclaimed that the persecution of these Muslims is against teachings of Lord Buddha, and if Buddha was alive today, he would have sided with the innocents. The reason behind his stance is that the element of non-violence is elementary to the Buddhist doctrine, as is this in the Dharmapada, collection of sayings attributed to Buddha. It says, and I quote, "If a man speaks or acts with an evil thought, pain follows him, as the wheel follows the foot of the ox that draws the carriage." It is unfortunate that the lesson that Buddha taught Hindus about equality around 6000 BC seems to be in response to which the Upanishads were developed to uphold the Hindu religion, as Hindu majority is once again making the same mistake by oppressing innocent human beings. That is their minorities, even though India claims to be a secular state which came to birth on this principle and is home to several religions. However, since its birth, the world has witnessed many incidents that clearly negate this perception, starting with the assassination of Mahatma Gandhi, the founder of the freedom movement, by a radical Hindu who belonged to the RSS. The core interest and ideology of the organization can be understood from the following paragraph. Here I quote, "The initial impetus was to provide corrective training through Hindu discipline and to unite the Hindu community to form a Hindu Rashtra, that is the Hindu nation. The organization promotes the ideal of upholding Indian culture and the values of civil society and spreads the ideology of Hinduvat to strengthen the Hindu community. It drew its initial inspiration from the European right-wing groups during World War II. It is unfortunate that India, being the largest democracy of the world, is being led by a party of Hindu extremists who are the followers of RSS and whose sole agenda is to cleanse India of all minorities. And thus is in no way different from what we have been practiced in Sri Lanka and Burma. Hindus belonging to this BJP, Bharatiya Janata Party, believe that India, also known as Hindustan, only belongs to them. Thus it is their duty to either kill or make the lives of the minorities so difficult that they leave this land on their own accord. Thus, Hindu sentiment was used by the ruling party to gain vested political interest, which became apparent when the ruling BJP party secured heavy majority in the 2019 election and imposed a curfew in the Valley of Kashmir on August 5, 2019, after revoking Article 370 of the Indian Constitution, especially undermining and crushing the rights of Kashmiri Muslims. Considering these incidents and the growing Hindu sentiment instigated by BJP in India, it seems that the first minority on the target list of ethnic cleansing are the Muslims of Kashmir. Now it is apparent that the Pulwama attack before the election was administrated by the Indian think tanks only to secure Hindu radical votes. However, this attack would have been the darkest day in the history of the Indian subcontinent, as it could have led towards destruction of such magnitude beyond which life would have been next to impossible. It is unfortunate that India, knowing that both countries are nuclearly equipped and war could be lethal for this region and the world, and which could have lasting consequences like shortage of food, premature ice age, carried out an action just to win the votes of the radical Hindus. Unfortunately, it seems that the government of these countries are only fulfilling one agenda, and that is ethnic cleansing, and it is no longer a fight of virtue, justice, or to save the Buddhist or Hindu religion, but a fight to sustain and enjoy power. Thus, the Buddhist majority nations like Sri Lanka and Burma, while the Hindu majority India are killing their innocent peaceful minorities, not for the greater good of humanity or to uphold their religious ideology taught by their leaders, but just to remain in power for their worldly gains. Thus, it is not a fight between Islam, Hinduism, or Buddhism, as this region, South and Southeast Asia, has been home to pluralistic religions in the past and has enjoyed peaceful regimes under many rulers. Rather, it is a fight against humanity, a peaceful world, and a better tomorrow for our future generations. However, the supporters of Buddhism argue that they have been a losing edge of history for over a millennium now. Before that time, nearly most of Asia was a Buddhist majority area, hence their primary field threatened by the rapid spread of Islam during this time period in the region. Countries like Malaysia, Indonesia, and Bangladesh are a few examples in the court to validate their stance. Therefore, countries like Sri Lanka and Burma have given open call for Buddhist nationalism to its majority Buddhist community to ensure that history is not repeated. Mong Young, an editor of a newspaper, in one of his recent interviews said, and I quote, that he harbors no hatred towards a Muslim, but the threat of Islamization is a foreseeable problem. We are not oppressing Muslims and we recognize their existence, but we do not want Muslims to swallow our country. Today, through this paper, the author has highlighted the importance of religion in the lives of South Asians since antiquity, and thus we must understand that no religion of the world teaches man to be unjust and cruel towards fellow beings. Therefore, the author urges the masses of these nations to foresee the consequences so that they are convinced to put a stop to the growing radical mindset before it's too late, as two countries of the religion are nuclear equipped. The world should not forget the incidents on August 6th and August 9, 1945, when the United States of America during World War II used a nuclear bomb against the Japanese cities of Hiroshima and Nagasaki in a combat. Finally, through this paper, the author urges Sri Lanka, Burmese, and Indian government to review and revisit their policies of using religion as a tool for achieving political gains, as these policies will not only bring devastation to South Asian region, but it will eventually topple their governments too, keeping in view the religious history of religion.
Where religion for brings, interrupting.
As these policies will not only bring devastation to South Asian region, but it will eventually topple their governments to keeping in view the religious history of this region, where religion has always been more important to men than political monarchs, and history has taught us that it is only a matter of time before the downfall of these regimes shall also begin, as the true essence of religion shall rise. Thank you. Thank you.
I now request our second speaker, Dr. Muzammil Khurshid. And I would please request all our respected presenters to please keep in mind the time limit, because we have to finish and end at 3:30.
Okay, ma'am. I have recorded my presentation already.
Please keep in mind all of the speakers. This is my...
Yes.
Keep your presentation.
May I start, ma'am?
Ji Muzammil.
Yes, sir, you may start.
is it visible?
Yes, sir. It's visible.
Okay.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum to all of you. I am Dr. Muzammil Khurshid, Assistant Professor, Department of Banking and Finance, University of the Punjab, Jalala Campus. Today, I am going to present my research article, Impact of Israeli Aggression on the Economy of Palestine. My co-author is Dr. Muzaffar Ali. This is the abstract of our research article. The purpose of this research paper is to analyze the effects of Israeli aggression on the Palestinian economy. The establishment of the State of Israel in the Middle East has shattered the peace of the whole world and the Arabs in particular. There have been dreadful wars between Israel and Palestine in 1948, 1956, 1967, and 1973. Moreover, there is always a state of war between the two. This oppressive situation has had a devastating effect on different sectors of the economy of Palestine, including agriculture, transportation, housing, education, and industry. Palestinians are not allowed to use their natural resources and resume economic activities. So there is a dire need for the analysis of the economic problems of Palestinians to establish a strong system of peace and the provision of the right of self-determination to them. This research paper has been presented for the achievement of this goal. The introduction of the research article. Palestine has an important place in the history of Islam in the religious and political context. It is also called the land of prophets. Its first winner is Hazrat Umar Farooq radhiyallahu ta'ala anhu. It is located on the southern shore of the Mediterranean in the west of the Asian continent. This area is now called the Middle East. It covers an area of 3,000 kilometers, including Hanafa and Gaza. When the Islamic world was targeted by the colonial powers and the land of Palestine came under British colonial rule, the Jews seized the opportunity and intensified their efforts to seize the region. Open in Jerusalem, it was the British government whose sole purpose was to serve the Jews. At the same time, Jews from all over the world began to gather in Jerusalem. At that time, there were only about 9,000 Jews in all the Palestine. Many wars have been fought since then, and the economic situation of the Palestinians has deteriorated. The Israeli aggression in Ramadan this year has caused a wave of grief and anger in the entire Muslim Ummah. The oppressed Palestinians in particular are in great pain. They have boycotted the economy, including the US and Israel. Unpleasant political conditions have destroyed the Palestinian economy. So in this context, the economic condition of the Palestinians can be well assessed. Their lands and properties were confiscated. They were forced to leave the country. This exploitation has led to animosity between Palestinians and Israelis, which has intensified over time. The objective of the study is to analyze the effects of the Palestinian-Israeli conflict on the economy impact of Israeli aggression on the economy of Palestine. This study is a descriptive study, and in this study, the focus is on the aggression, the Israeli aggression on the economy of Palestine. The Israeli-Palestinian conflict has had a devastating effect on the Palestinian economy. Fraud and jobs have been created, a state of panic among the people. In this Ramzan, Muslims were martyred in an aggressive attack on Al-Aqsa Mosque by Israel. The people are in a state of anxiety due to mental stress and panic. People's jobs have been lost. According to a World Bank report, the Palestinian economy is losing $3.4 billion a year in a trade due to Israeli sanctions. The report says that if Israel lifts sanctions on the 61% occupied West Bank, the Palestinians will be able to bring their shaky economy to 35% of GDP. The Palestinian economy is weakening, and the Gaza Strip's GDP has fallen by 8%. The World Bank has described the Palestinian economy as unstable in recent days, as unemployment in the West Bank and Gaza Strip has risen to 30%. Unemployment in the Gaza Strip, which has been paralyzed by Israeli blockades for nearly a decade, was 52% last year. The U.S. ambassador to the Middle East said the purpose of the Manama conference is to remove obstacles to the incredible potential of the Palestinian and regional economies. The growing distance between the two economies, two countries, administrations in recent months has cost the Palestinian government millions of dollars. Similarly, due to budget cuts, the Palestinian government has ordered the withholding of salaries of more than 100,000 employees. Now, the conclusion. As we have discussed that the purpose of this study is to check the impact of Israeli aggression on the economy of Palestine, the direct victims of Israeli aggression are the Palestinians. They have completely put pressure on the Palestinians politically, socially, and economically. Their lands and properties were forcibly taken from the Palestinians. They were rightly banned. They use their natural resources. They are not allowed to resume economic activities. As a result, per capita income has dropped drastically. This exploitation has led to many wars between Palestinians and Israelis. There is a positive solution to the conflicts, complexities, and conflicts between the two communities that can play an important role in today's calm global environment and basic human rights. The economic development of the Palestinians requires that Israel be stopped from aggression. A new environment free of conflict over sovereignty and a clear and well-defined authority over economic activities can take the Palestinian economy a long way toward a higher path of development and growth. Such a new and enabling environment would cement a new economic relation between the two economies. That is all about my presentation. Thank you. If you have any question, you can ask.
Okay, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Amreen, you are not audible.
Is it okay now?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Zara, please keep in mind the time limitation for each presenter.
Yes, ma'am. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Then can you please call the next presenter?
Yeah, I did that. Dr. Kurutulain Tahira, please, can you begin your presentation?
Assalamu alaikum. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am, you are audible.
Okay. Wait for a moment. Let me. Let me upload the slide first. From present now, I will move. I'm currently not able to start my slideshow. The entire screen, okay. Can you see now?
Yes, ma'am, it's visible.
Okay. So I'm Dr. Kurutulain Tahira, assistant professor of rabbit department in Lahore College for my university. I'm going to present the paper on Palestine-Israel border crisis, a comparative insight of English rabbit news sources. This paper is a joint effort. My co-author in this paper is Sadia Tahira, who is an independent scholar. As we all know, that recent Palestine-Israel border crisis has increased human rights violation. This crisis has caused further impairment of human geography and human rights of Palestinians. Israel attempts to gain control over Palestine through demographic politics is the root cause behind the ongoing crisis. I will try to critically analyze and compare the coverage of human rights violation in English and Arabic news sources and media. An insight on the current uprising. Here are two pictures. You can see on one on the left shows this one shows the systematic Israeli illegal settlement on the border at Sheikh Jarrah, Jerusalem. This is the main bone of contention, which is the demographic control of the population. As the Jews are purchasing houses forcibly in the neighborhood of Sheikh Jarrah, matter was in the court, Palestinians started protesting against Israeli killer and state violence. So Israel, like always, in order to disperse the protest, attacked the Al-Aqsa Mosque, while you can see the picture on the right portrayed two Palestinian girls sitting playing on the unexploded Israeli missile. This shows extreme violation of human rights time. About the objective of this paper, I would like to say that I have tried to find some of the answers to the questions like how English and Arab media is reporting this crisis, role of media in generating policies, political discourse, what are the implications that the media present for this crisis, as though are those implications creating and following ethnic bias or aimed at providing equal human rights to everyone? As we know, the UNO Universal Declaration of Human Rights says that necessity and importance of free media is equally the basic right for every human being. Talking about the methodology of this paper, I would like to say that in context of state control through biopower, Foucault argues that public opinion is generated on the basis of national interest, in which political and biological factors are involved. Whereas in the present day, governmental policies and its outcomes are presented to the population through media that includes electronic and print media. In the Foucault lexicon, it can be seen that control of life through politics to some extent, that even dictating who may live and who must die become a norm. Then such form of politics become necropolitics. The next slide. Let's talk about political discourse analysis. As you know, the rationale behind implementing this analysis is to examine the argument on both sides, then what role power plays in the dialogue. Relief Web, working under UNO, reports the need for a statement by UN Security Council to stop Israel. But on the contrary, UN Security Council was not even able to hold public session on the crisis, as the US blocked the council. Even media reports the crisis and mention Israeli president's comments, who described the crisis as pogrom. And what is pogrom? Pogrom is a violent operation that is aimed at the massacre or expulsion of an ethnic or religious group. So in this context, news coverage by Arab and English media openly present Palestinians as victim. Such remarks by Israeli president clearly shows that Israel is playing victim, and extermination of Palestinians is justified by Israeli state narrative. American newspaper like New York Times has mostly taken side with the Israeli narrative, whereas media like BBC and The Guardian have advocated for the Palestinian rights and cause, while Arab media has fully supported Palestinian cause and rights. As we know, the Al Jazeera documented that Palestinians are being silenced on social media. Content related to Israeli violence against Palestinians' families at Sheikh Jarrah was systematically censored on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. The picture you see, I hope you can read it, because I cannot play the slideshow here. Maybe in that case, the screen can be off. So in this picture, you can see it was published by Human Rights Watch in April 2021. It clearly shows identity crisis and ethnic bias that a Palestinian resident has to face, in contrast with the Jewish citizen, is due to imbalance in the region. Now I will talk about the results and conclusion of this paper. You can see in this picture, she is Michael Mayan, Israeli diplomat. She justifies of the Palestinians by saying we can't put all these people in jail. This clearly shows that Israel's state policy has become necropolitics. Whereas we can see that some days ago, the picture on your, we can see Al Jazeera journalist. She was arrested at Jarrah because she was reporting the Israeli violence. So need for free press has become near to impossible in highly controlled state of Israel. Now talking about the conclusion of this paper, I would say that human rights representation of Palestinian in media shows ethnic bias. Moreover, they are presented as if they are on par with the Israeli state, whereas Israeli narrative them as terrorists. So political discourse is set to decimate and discriminate. Arab and English media that shows Israel's real face to the world is ascribed anti-Semitic. Interestingly, the usage of this term is essentially flawed. Linguistically, Semitic means people belonging to or speaking a Semitic language, the Jews or Arabs. Therefore, anyone can be called anti-Semitic who is either against Jews or the Arabs. But the specific use of this term is aimed at creating identity differences. So along with demographic control through seizure of land, other issues like erosion of identity and ethnic bias also seems to be rife. Such terms are cover and silence the narrative belonging to the opposite side. Israel counter strategy is to hide the plight of Palestinian in the media. The criteria of representation of human rights in journalistic terms mostly on financial constraints. This is the main reason why some of the media is not reporting the Palestinian rights very clearly in their channels. So financial involvement plays crucial in projection and representation of human rights issue, as the American press and UN seems to be silenced by the economic and financial aid by the Israel, whereas the rest of the world through electronic and social media has shown full support for the Palestinian rights. So here I end my paper. Thank you very much. Like if you have any question in this regard. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. Dr. Amreen, can we call the next presenter? Okay, I think she is facing some technical issues. So can we please have ma'am Rabia Amir for her presentation? Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Rabia. It's good to see you here and looking forward to your presentation.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much for gracing this occasion for I'm just about to present.
Well, good luck.
Thank you. Let me know if my presentation is visible.
It's visible and it's audible both.
Okay. But I can't see it. That's strange.
It's not visible.
Okay.
It's not visible yet.
Okay, let me just now if you can just let me know.
Yes, now they are visible, ma'am.
Okay.
Rabia, continue.
Okay. Well, I can't see this. How am I going to manage it?
Can't you see the screen? Aapki screen pe
okay. Yes, now it's visible.
Okay.
So, imperialism and the. Can I just make it? No, it's not. It's not possible. Anyway, imperialism and the modern world is the topic that I'm going to speak today about. It is a kind of a theorizing for neocolonialism in Kashmir and settler colonialism in Palestine. I'm sorry, I can't make it happen. Can anybody else help me with this?
Rabia, go ahead.
We can hear you.
I know you can hear me, but you can't see the slides which I have prepared with such a big.
see the slides.
Okay, let me just. Is it visible?
Yes, ma'am.
And the slides are moving?
Yes, ma'am. They are moving.
They are.
All right. A successful Viennese journalist, a less successful playwright with no political ambitions, and the father of modern Zionism, Theodor Herzl, makes one pertinent observation in his 1896 and 1904 document, The Jewish State. He writes that all the attempts of colonizing the Jews, even by the really benevolent men, have so far been unsuccessful. Similarly, Shashi Tharoor argues in his 2017 book, Inglorious Empire. If these arguments are stretched to the present times, it may be argued that if any attempts to colonize Jews or Indians had been unsuccessful, then how can we apply the same formula on Palestinians or Kashmiris? An adjoining argument can be that if attempts of any colonizing are bound to fail, then what is this isolation that Israel is practicing vis-a-vis Palestine or India in the case of Kashmir? I argue that the appropriation of land, culture, and resources, marginalization, and erasure meted out to the Kashmiris and Palestinians is beyond the hegemonic strategies of either imperialism or colonialism. Let's look at the definitions of the two terms. Colonialism is defined as the policy or practice of acquiring full or partial political control over another country, occupying it with settlers and exploiting it economically, while imperialism is a policy of extending a country's power and influence through diplomacy and military force. So while colonialism has been thriving on the metaphors of educating the and civilizing the innumerable millions, white man's burden, imperialism has bothered to itself to borrow only some of these tropes from colonialism. It works more on these lines, a land without a people, for a people without land, or transmitters of European civilization to the uncivilized, or agricultural settlements of Palestine. And lastly but not least, every nation in every region has a decision to make, either it is with us or with the terrorists. So the synthesis of colonialism and imperialism gives rise to despotism and fascism, something also discussed in Calder's book, in 2018 book, Dictator Literature. This synthesis of despotism and fascism simply disregards any option to bother itself with any such euphemisms that colonialism thrived upon. Neither does despotism has any use of this vocabulary, nor bothered by its imports. So the previous century's recklessness causing the two world wars has ostensibly resulted in decolonizing in many parts of the world, including India. While the question of Jewish colony in Europe resulted in Eretz Israel, however, the subsequent world order thriving on colonial Cold War is culminating into a praxis that is witnessing a recolonialism, a re-imperialism, despotism, and fascism, which I have called as imperialism. The statistics of Indian atrocities in Kashmir and Israel's in Palestine are such slender questions that even Wagner can decide, as Faustus would argue, especially when we see unrestrained genocide being carried out against humanity in the two places. This is what qualifies this imperial colonial despotism in the two realms to be beyond colonialism and imperialism. This then becomes a combination of not only colonialism and imperialism in their most heinous and barbaric forms, but also has a fair share of fascism and despotism, and thus may be neologized as imperialism. Indian neocolonialism and Israel's settler colonialism, it may be argued, therefore, is in the phase of colonialism, imperialism, and despotism from which it had sought to liberate itself more than 75 years ago. The predecessors occasionally bothered themselves to table some justifications for their policies of erasure and marginalization and genocide, but this carte blanche witnessed in Kashmir and Palestine today, with least bit of accountability, may be seen as imperialism. The post-colonial environmental ethic of the two places, however, with its attendant methods of inquiry, as manifested in some Kashmiri and Palestinian writings, question and impedes the unrestricted blank check. There is value in entertaining the possibility that if this imperialism is not checked, it has the tendency of establishing the similar patterns of imperialism, colonialism, despotism, and fascism in other parts of the world. So thus subverting some the pervasive category of knowledge making, we may argue that this imperialism, besides having physical implications as witnessed in Kashmir and Palestine day in and day out, has ideological underpinnings as well. This imperialism does not care much for any cover statements and is unscrupulous because it is not bothered by any environmental ethical concerns of the existing populations. It crosses all limits of consciousness for humanity and human laws, which some historians and critics described as unbridled ethnocracy that grossly discriminates against certain of its citizens, as Sand would argue, or define as creeping apartheid, as Plonsky has says. So especially when we now know that Palestinians are the original inhabitants of this land, embracing Judaism, Christianity, and Islam in different periods of history, as Sand has argued in his book. This term also has implications of implosion, that is self-destruction and destructing predilections, because they are not environmentally sustainable in the long run. I say this because Europeans suppressing the Jewish question in Europe and colonizing in India had to answer for their misdeeds eventually. The Nuremberg trials of the perpetrators of Holocaust and British rollback in India can be cited as example. Alternatively, it can be said that colonizing and appropriating all possible resources, both physical and psychological, with all possible means is what makes this phenomenon of imperialism or colonial imperialism holding sway yonder than what colonialism or imperialism could accomplish in the first half of the 20th century. It is not that both these terms are not interchangeable. They definitely are. They most definitely are. However, they borrow heavily, and they also borrow heavily from each other. But an ism like imperialism that I am suggesting is a practice of exercising absolute power that allows for doing away with any explanatory positions that either colonialism or imperialism had ostensibly maintained throughout history. It has no qualms or trepidations for any accountability of the like Nuremberg trials, and perhaps exercise indemnity in the vein of witch hunting trials of Salem, Massachusetts. In the context of Kashmir and Palestine, it is the employing of unrestrained an ongoing genocide, excruciatingly brutal, egregious, and unspeakable crimes against humanity in the 21st century that this colonial imperialism or its protege imperialism has absolutely no transparency for its ideological state apparatuses or repressive state apparatuses, as Althusser would argue, and has a complete disregard to the environmental ethic of a place that qualifies it to be beyond anything and is called imperialism. And therefore, it calls for a de-Indianization in Kashmir or a de-Zionization, as Sand argues, in the context of Palestine. I consider it a natural affinity for that any Christian is going to feel for any Christian, a Muslim for any Muslim, or Jew for another Jew. But that does not entail that all Muslims, Christians, or Jews can be confined in geographical blocks. That would be ethno-nationalism or parochial nationalism. But a nationalism like America, saying that America has always civil rights irrespective of race and religion, or a Christian or a Parsi living in Pakistan has equal rights irrespective of race, religion, or caste, color, or creed, is what I call multicultural, transcultural, cosmopolitan nationalism. Humanity is not a flock of sheep to be put in separate pens. If she is a Muslim or a Jew or a Christian or a Hindu or a Sikh or a Buddhist. So if Israel, India, or the Arab nations, those who exercise these parochial nationalisms, claim a Jewish identity to offer its nations, or a Hindutva mindset, or a Saudi or an Arab to become a mutualized citizen of that place, it goes beyond parochial nationalism, worse than any colonialism or imperialism of the 20th century. And therefore, if for emphasis sake, I call it imperialism, which is more than any imperialism, colonialism, fascism, or despotism. The first syllable of imperialism can denote the first three letters of imperialism. The second and the third syllables may be a symbol of colonialism, while the last syllable stands for the fascism and despotism that we witness in the context of Kashmir and Palestine. This colonial settler colonialism or impregnated militarism, this is the last page, if I can. Unaccountable for their imperialism is what makes today's world not post-colonial world, but post-imperial world. The human beings who are facing the brunt of such shameful, hateful, brutal, egregious, and unspeakable crimes of imperialism are imperialized people living in a post-imperialized world with lowest possible subalternized positions of an imperialized entity and the real wretchedness of the earth. We should not be critical of any generic nationalism as criticized by many anti-nationalists or who raise objections to nationalism, but the parochial nationalism is what I call imperialism that should be weeded out of the truly multicultural, multi-ethnic, equally based nationalism with a sense of hope, belonging, a belonging that does not have a dagger under its every arm to slaughter anyone with different caste, color, or creed. However, as Hannah Arendt would argue that a bunch of lies or pack of lies are bought easier than truth. So that is quite a task to bring that to the surface. Though through this theorizing, I offer an aid for any future research in these or any similar areas, as Derrida proposes in Spectres of Mars, and he says, and I quote, international law should extend and diversify its field to include, if at least it is to be consistent with the idea of democracy and of human rights it proclaims. So, with this, I come to the last part. Therefore, the settler colonialism of Israel and Indian occupation of Kashmir may be called colonial imperialism, a phenomenon that extends the implications of both colonialism and imperialism and is neologized as imperialism. This imperialism is more aggressive due to sheer savagery of attacks, shows the moral depravity of the oppressors, and use a hammer against a fly phenomenon. Thus, the world communities are being put under erasure, may be seen through the lens of post-imperialism. I thank you for, thank you. That's all from my side.
Thank you, Rabia. Now we come over to our next presenter, Dr. Fatma Sajjad. Fatma, are you with us?
Ma'am, it's Sundas Basharat. Ma'am, Sundas Basharat.
Sundas?
Yes, ma'am. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum.
Ma'am Rabia, can you allow me to present? Because your screen is still sharing. Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, Sundas, go ahead.
Yes, ma'am. I'm about to share my presentation. Can you see my presentation?
Yes, ma'am. They're visible.
Okay. So, assalamu alaikum, everyone. This is a joint effort by myself, Sundas Basharat. I'm a PhD IR scholar at UMT Lahore, and my professor, Dr. Fatma Waqi Sajjad, she's associate professor. The title of the presentation is Media and Peace Building Between India and Pakistan, the Case of Kartarpur Corridor. I would not go into the detail of the sequence. It is flashed in front of you just to save some time. So let's begin with the introduction. The conflict-ridden, war-prone, and locked in security dilemma, India-Pakistan relationship seems to be a complicated phenomena comprising intrastate and interstate issues and disputes affecting the regional peace and security since the last seven decades. The portrayal of these issues, conflicts, disputes, and attempts of peaceful settlements are all represented and broadcasted through the media nationally and internationally. We know that media has assumed prime importance and a powerful position in the contemporary world today, particularly in opinion making, shaping perceptions, and constructing social relations at the national and international level. So considering this context. This research studied the relationship between media and peace building in the India-Pakistan relations. The role of media in peace building activities between the two states were analyzed by considering the opening of the Kartarpur corridor in 2019. Let's go a little bit into the literature, and I'll be very quick with it. As we did the literature review, we saw that the media has become the arena of war and peace in India and Pakistan. And the two countries' press is historically progressing with time. And media between India and Pakistan has actually blurred the factual coverage of events in the subcontinent, resulting in conflict journalism. Often it is questioned, what is the objectivity of media? And the objectivity in media is questioned because it is totally related to national interest. So whatever the national interest is, the media is going to portray the same thing. Now, when it comes to India and Pakistan, media have been consistent with the scholarship on the nexus between media and foreign policy. So you see that foreign policy, meaning media is what the foreign policy wishes it to speak out. Both countries' media, after thorough research, has been seen that media is jingoistic, war-oriented, escalatory, due to the lopsided notion of ultra-nationalism and decades-old enmity. We selected the case of opening of the Kartarpur corridor on 9th November. Prime Minister Imran Khan declared that he and his government will open the corridor for the Sikh because it's a holy land for the Sikhs. So this was and this can be taken as one of the major steps between the two countries to reconcile, to build peace. In this context, there are two questions that were raised in this research article. How has the print media promoted the peace building event during the opening of Kartarpur corridors in the year 2019? And number two, how can media promote peace building in the region in future? So we proposed a hypothesis as well, and it said Pakistani and Indian media, print media, are building peace through Kartarpur corridor. Let's see if it is true or not. Now, the theoretical framework that we selected is by Dr. Johan Galtung, called the Peace Journalism Framework. He says that there are two ways to report a conflict. Either it is the highway, where everything is seen in a conflict manner. It is seen as war or violence. But then there is a low way where conflict is seen as conflict transformation and a way to build peace. So this was actually the theoretical framework. The methodology that we followed was qualitative content analysis, the sampling, the universe of the study, the Dawn from Pakistan and the Hindu from India were selected. The time frame was October to December 2019, 1 month before the event and 1 month after the event. So the combination of news and editorial pertaining to the opening of Kartarpur corridor were selected. And then operationalization of the categorization was done by declaring into three categories: positive, negative, and neutral. So positive discussed all about peace building, successful dialogues, reconciliations. Negative discussed about criticism. They do not support goodwill gestures. They're not creating any sense of harmony. And the neutral are neither in the favor of the peace process, nor they give any kind of solution. So overall, 67 combination of news articles and editorials were selected, and 36 from the Dawn and 31 were from the Hindu. Now, as the results identified, and they declared that there were 46 articles and editorials, they were positive in nature, while 12 were negative in nature and 10 were neutral in nature. This states that Pakistani media and Indian media, in the context of Kartarpur corridor, is actually trying to build peace. We were not satisfied just to do the content analysis, so we thought we should do some thematic analysis as well. We took out almost six, seven themes. The first one was enhancing religious tourism. You see, when you are actually building a corridor of religion, religious identity, so you're enhancing religious tourism, then there is promotion of positive role of media. there is an attempt of conflict resolution. And like we know about multi-track diplomacy, it actually maximized the role of multi-track diplomacy by not only just track two, but also other avenues of multi-track diplomacy were involved. Now, important thing is, one saw that there is internal pressure between the two countries, not only internally, but externally. So that should be something which should be minimized. And then there was support from international community. China was supporting the two countries. USA on its part was supporting the two countries to reconcile. And an astonishing thing came in as a result, that was the rise of social media and age of digital diplomacy, because then hashtag Kartarpur corridor, hashtag 550 Prabhu's birthday was introduced. So this is how we did the thematic analysis. Coming to the conclusion, we saw several factors on can influence media, but among these, the internal political makeup needs to have a balanced approach. Now, blame gaming each other's government is not going to help either of the two. Religious tourism can enhance interfaith harmony, resulting into peace building and peaceful coexistence of two very different cults of religion together. So now media has to be transparent and away from the shackles of all kinds of restriction to facilitate peace in the region. Here, one cannot forget the role of tracks of multi-track diplomacy that can actually promote and establish long-term peace and harmony, and eventually can win the hearts and minds of conflicting parties. Similarly, like I said in the previous slide, rise of social media, age of digital diplomacy can give rise to parallel medium of building narratives and creating soft image of each other. If we want peace through journalism for each other country, we need cross-border information, providing more reportage of economic, infrastructural, and cultural issues, reinforcing journalism, best practices, easing visa restrictions, and restrictions on each other's media, training workshops for reporters on specific subjects like Kashmir, terrorism, war resources, Siachen, etc. Then monitoring TV shows and developing a code of ethics. But most importantly, we need to have a website to allow editors and media practitioners to engage with each other across the border and help diffuse the tensions. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Sundas. And now we have our last presenter, Dr. Huzaifa Pandit. Yes. Please, may I request you to begin your presentation? Thank you.
Thank you. Assalamu alaikum, everyone. I'm going to Huzaifa. Can you see my presentation? Is my presentation visible?
Yes, it is.
Yes, sir, it's visible.
So I'm going to talk about Agha Shahid Ali's book of poems, The Country Without a Post Office. The title of my paper is Whose Nation Is It? Contesting Loss in the Country Without a Post Office. So when we look at my paper, basically, you know, it's a, except that I'm going to present a part, a small part of a larger argument in which I have tried to locate Agha Shahid Ali, you know, as a poet, you know, as a poet who is, does, whose poetry doesn't provide a transparent view of occupation in Kashmir, but it represents a, you know, a complex and contradictory idea of resistance. And from there, I have tried to identify that resistance to nationalism eventually implies that one cannot think of nationalism, one cannot think of resistance, and one cannot think of a nation in a linear way, but must necessarily include a multifaceted movement, but must include necessary multiple ways, multiple and contradictory ways at the same time. So my paper, therefore, is, what I've tried to do is argue against the traditional reception of Agha Shahid Ali, which is that he is a poet of Kashmiri resistance and is an authentic voice of Kashmiri resistance. My paper argues that, well, that is true, that Agha Shahid Ali is a voice of Kashmiri resistance, but this resistance is, located in a particular class and historical space, which must be delineated for us to understand clearly how literary resistance to occupation occurs. So I'm going to start. Agha Shahid Ali's Country Without a Post Office has often been reduced to a catalogue of extraordinary topographies of trauma, loss and death that erupted in Kashmir beginning with 1990. A lot of people have this mythical idea, erroneous idea, that Kashmir conflict starts with 1990. Till then things were peaceful. Of course, I refer to the Indian part of Kashmir, not the Pakistani part of Kashmir. But this reductive reading, when we think that Agha Shahid Ali's book is only concerned with the delineating the topographies of trauma, loss and death, it is a reductive reading of Agha Shahid Ali, which does no justice to the complexity of the poems, which offer a counter movement to occupation and counter movement to thinking of Kashmir as a singular nation, of thinking of Kashmir as something that is occupied by India, and resistance as arising in reaction to that resistance. So my paper tries to move away from these binarizing approach. So it tries to look at, how Agha Shahid Ali's privilege and cultural wealth informs his poetry, and how does that inform his notion of resistance. So this reading draws attention to the contradictory longing in him that resists a binarizing and totalizing approach to imagining the nation, Kashmir and India, as located in a binary of oppressed and oppressor, victim and assailant. And therefore, it calls for, a necessity, it calls for, a remapping of Kashmiri identity in historical space and time. But the question is, why does this binary need to be, removed? Quite often, and, Kashmir has been thought of this place that is ravaged by occupation and Kashmiris as uncontested victims. Why, therefore, must be introduced a contestation of these categories? This binary needs to be dismantled, first of all. Why? Because it's a replication of the way the state functions. When the state functions by, making something legal and something illegal, by something as allowed and something as which is not allowed. All right, it functions by marking binaries of acceptability, non-acceptability, accessible versus inaccessible, which part of the road you can move from, which part of the road you cannot move from. And it looks at people in a binary, civilian versus terrorist, and marks spaces out clearly. All right, for example, a camp, which is inaccessible, a road, which is accessible, but a police station, which is again a mystical place, an interrogation center, which works by, concealment and mythicizing it. Checkpoint, bunker, road. These spaces are opaque. Why? Because the general Kashmiri population is neither permitted to access them, nor are they informed about these spaces. You have no idea. Suddenly you're walking down the road one day and you see a bunker has come up. They do not ask your consent. All right, these are imposed on the public without their consent. So first of all, since binarizing is a stable, is a way of, conceptualizing, stable conceptualization, that the state works, right, that the state tries to work by rigidly dividing, by partitioning the people and the land so that it can keep an eye, so that it can regulate the routines and roots of everyday life, it is necessary to disrupt this binarizing movement. Moreover, also since poetry conflates geographies and times, these contradictions and contests in the text become an articulation not of the fixed space of a nation state, but a vehicle of potentialities, okay? A disruptive and transformative space of contraptional trajectories where divergent and distant spaces blend by aid of an active imagination. So this imagination that I'm referring to exists not in a, you know, not in conceptualizing a linear image of a nation, but it exists in constant negotiation. Now the term I'm using here is negotiation. That means it does not include only, you know, it does not only include a passive resistance to trauma or to occupation, and but it also reveals that there is a mutual, some sort of give and take. This is a constant negotiation and tension between the roots of subjugation and between the roots and the roots of subjugation and resistance. Right? So when you have this narration of collective trauma, right, that is constantly in a flux that cannot be imagined by a singular conceptualization, what can be employed to generate a greater mutuality and inclusiveness? So such spaces then, poetic spaces, move beyond mere representative allegories. So Agha Shah Delhi's Country Without a Post Office ceases to become a representative allegory of Kashmir. Rather, it actively debates and depicts the protean politics of occupation and resists portrayal of monolithic counter responses. So what we are arguing is here that, you know, it does not think of nation states as conceived of singular imaginations or singular ideas or singular politics, that this is a part that has to be, this is a land that has to be occupied and we are, you know, different from it, but rather a constant negotiation occurs, you know, between the land and the people, between the occupier and the occupied. The title poem, Country Without a Post Office, exhibits this contradictory moment and draws from the image already used in the poem Pastoral, which precedes it. So if you have read the poem Pastoral, you'll see that the image of Country Without a Post Office are similar to it. The desolate homes, fire, lamps being lit, smoke, undelivered letters, maps and the mirror, saffron, soaked blood, along with the sounds. So you have the call for the prayer, the calling out to people lost, to quote Shahid, it's us, as well as the protagonists on, you know, around whom this, these symbols, these images occur. The Muezzin, the soldiers, the estranged friend, now a refugee, and the speaker returning from exile. I've quoted, you know, some lines here. I have returned in vain to find him, to learn why he never wrote. I have brought cash, a currency of paisleys, to buy the new stamps. They are already blank, no nation named on them. When the Muezzin died, the city was robbed of every call. It's raining, I write this, as I write this, I have no prayer, it's just a shout held in. It's us, whose letters are cries that break like bodies in prisons. My interest is in these, is, you know, provoked by the lines wherein he speaks of, I have brought cash, a currency of paisleys, to buy new stamps, which are blank and no nation named on them. These are very pertinent lines because they evoke to us the commerce of occupation. It mirrors that, you know, occupation is not just a military apparatus, but it also has, you know, other apparatuses appended to it, including an economical, psychological, and ideological apparatus. Okay? To this paraphernalia that I outlined above, Shahid adds paisley. As you can see here, a paisley is a motif shaped like an upturned teardrop with a curved upper end and sometimes thought to represent an almond or blossom. Both images traditionally signify feminine beauty. We look at Ghazal poetics, you know, blossom and almonds, you know, have been badam chishn, have been used to represent female beauty. Feminine beauty, almond symbolizes shapely eyes and blossom delicacy of beauty and tender complexion. Unsurprisingly then, the Kashmiri shawl, a rage in colonial Europe, especially France and England, became associated with Paisley since his femininity gels well with the Occidental gaze that feminizes the colony. So what we see here is that it is a reminder that Shahid's poetry must be examined in a more critical way, because Paisley does not just evoke the binary of oppressed versus oppressor, but also a historical context. It's a reiteration of the Oriental imagery of associating Kashmir with a passive mother beloved in need of rescue, and Shahid's desire to perform this messianic role. If you see here in the previous lines, he says, "I brought cash, a currency of Paisley's, to buy the nation." So what is he, interposing? He's interposing this gaze, the Occidental gaze, all right, where the Orient is to be rescued by the Occident, by way of, giving them an ontology. Excuse
me, sir. Yeah. Sorry for interrupting. Can I please request you to conclude your presentation?
Are my 10 minutes over?
Yes, sir.
All right. I'll just focus and finish it here. By offering the currency of Paisley as the price to redeem and recover the pre-colonial pastoral, in a shrine of words, Shahid reiterates the mercenary nature of occupation and its ideological underpinning. Moreover, the speaker can afford to purchase newsreel stamps with Paisley when all other stamps are cancelled and the post office is dead. This privilege mirrors the privilege enjoyed historically by elite Muslim class in Kashmir, where the common Muslim faced deprivation, extreme poverty, no access to education, but elite Muslim families like Naqshbandis and Aghas during the Afghan, Sikh and Dogra rule bucked this trend. So I've tried to delineate the historical background of the Agha family, how Agha family profited from occupation of Kashmir, from colonization of Kashmir by previous colonialists before Indian colonization came into being. So I'm talking about how this possession of Paisley currency is in the articulation of immunity from the routine deprivation and violence. So we've tried to examine the same trend, the contradictory impulse in return to harmony. So what I'm finally concluded is that, his gesture to nullify colonialism by blank stamps, which stamp out the seals of colonial treaties and interventions, is rooted in a nostalgia for this privilege, even though it's employed as a counter-colonial instrument. So what I've argued is that the evocation of nostalgia is a reminder against weaving counter-colonial gestures as motivated by a single generic belief in a nationalist ideal. Rather, it's shaped by diverse and often competing interests and is an attestation of the contradictions manifest in Shahid that caution against the unconditional celebration of his poetry as the voice of Kashmiri subalternity. So what I've argued is, I'm not saying that Kashmiri Shahid's poetry is not significant for conceptualizing the conflict, but I'm saying that he is a product of particular histories. Right? It does not happen within a void, but within histories regulated by asymmetrical power relations, and often, as in Ellie's case, at the intersection of dissimilar and often conflicting cultures and traditions. Thank you. Let me end my presentation. Okay. Is my presentation, has it ended?
Thank you, Dr. Huzaifa.
Thank you.
That was an interesting presentation from your side. So with this, we conclude our all of our presentations. And this was a session in which most of the papers were related with Kashmir and Palestine. And we see that these two issues have been the unresolved disputes. They are the longest unresolved disputes that we are seeing in contemporary times. And in both the disputes, we have seen how there is violation of human rights. And very tragically, in both the cases, it is regarding the oppression of Muslims. And tragically, we see that there is silence from the world regarding whatever is going on in these two areas, in these two disputed areas, or these two disputes. And all of the presenters, they presented their viewpoints regarding mostly on these issues from different prospects. I first of all appreciate my appreciation to all the presenters for their interesting, informative, and enlightening presentations, papers. Well done, all of you. Thank you for participating in this well-organized conference, the first international conference by arts and humanities. And I can see Dr. Amra sitting in front of me, even though on a screen. But well done, Dr. Amra.
Thank you. Dr. Amra, thank you very much who have taken time out to chair this session. It's indeed a privilege for all of us. Thank you so much. And whatever I've heard from the session, I enjoyed myself very much. Zara, thank you very much for being there. And all the presenters, I think that your presentations gave us new insight and new perspectives and perhaps new hope as well. Thank you, Dr. Amreen, for bringing and highlighting these various issues. Thank you.
Okay, so we will conclude here, our panel here. I would like to thank our respectable chair, Dr. Amreen Javed, for her worthy presence, and all the presenters and the attendees for your contribution and interest. Also, the recording of the session will be shared with the chair and the presenters. However, if any attendee wants to have the recording, they may send an email to the coordinator. Thank you so much, everyone. Have a nice day.
Bye-bye.